Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming. Okay, so we're really excited to have our public event with James Aspey today, who's our special guest coming in from Australia. And his partner, Carly Taylor, is also here, and she's from Canada. So without further ado, I'm first going to introduce Senator Mike Gabbard. He is our only vegan legislator in Hawaii, and he's also Tulsi Gabbard's father. But he was actually a politician long before that. And he's the chair of the Senate Committee on Agriculture and Environment. So Senator Gabbard.
Hello, Mike Ako. Great to be here, and thank you for coming. I do want to mention and also thank you to all the sponsors, Vegetarian Society, Good Food Movement. What a great thing you guys are doing. And just to emphasize how important it is that we're all in this together and we need to be working together, right? And that's the, you know, as a policymaker, I was elected to the Senate in 2006. In 2008, we actually passed a concurrent resolution in the House and the Senate saying that we should have vegan and vegetarian options for our school lunch program. 2008. And as the wheels of government turn painfully slowly sometimes, it took about 5 years for the Department of Education to actually take that seriously. And so now we have vegan and vegetarian options in all of our public schools. So, but again, you know, it's teamwork. It's everybody doing whatever they're doing and working together for our same goal. I do have a surprise here for our guest speaker. James, would you come forward, please? I have a proclamation from the State Senate. I don't know if they do this down under, but
that's never happened to me before.
Okay, all right, all right.
I don't know what I'm doing.
All right. So this is a proclamation from the Senate honoring and commending James Aspey. Currently, James focuses his energy on being a prominent voice for young people while promoting the vegan lifestyle grounded in a foundation of morality and ethics. James travels around the world telling his story and also inspires tens of millions of people online through his recorded speeches and video posts about going vegan. James speaks strongly about treating others with respect and has a unique, non-judgmental, compassionate, and compelling way of reaching people's hearts. Quote, my goal is to increase peace through education, encouragement, and inspiration, unquote. The Hawaii State Senate hereby honors and commends James Aspey. Mahalo for your efforts to raise awareness about animal cruelty while inspiring a world of nonviolence and compassion. We welcome you to Hawaii with aloha e komo mai.
Mahalo. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Hold it there, and they want to take a picture there, I think.
Absolutely.
Whoops. Okay. Okay. Now, did they do this down under? Or you got the shot?
Yeah, we do that everywhere.
Ready? One, two, three.
Okay. We good? All right. Yo, what's up? Whoa, that was cool. This is cool. Smells great. What a great part of the world. They just come and put beautiful flowers on you, and you smell great for the rest of the day. So thank you very much. And thank you everybody who made today and the rest of the events here possible. What I want to talk about today, it's something hard to put into words in a lot of ways because the magnitude of it is so enormous that the numbers that I talk about and the talk about suffering and pain and things like that, it's actually almost impossible to grasp and to empathize with because the numbers are just too big for our human minds to have a concept of what they mean. And so me personally, and I think a lot of people, instead of going, okay, so billions, so how many individuals is that? And you kind of try to figure it out. Instead, your mind just goes, I don't know what that number is. And you don't even really go there. Same with when I talk about suffering and violence and the pain and all these kind of things, which I am going to talk about today. It's unfortunate, but it's something that really needs to be talked about. Talking about those things only points to it, you know? It points to an action. It points to a feeling that they go through, that we sometimes go through as well. So I just want to say before I start that try to really think about the words that I'm using, not just as throwaway words, but actually what they mean. You know, the meanings of the words, the meaning behind these, the meaning of the numbers that I'm talking about. Just to try to give a little bit more effort into comprehending what it is I'm talking about, because it is really hard to grasp with just these words that really, it's very hard to do it justice with words, but I'm going to try my best today. So again, thank you all for being here. This is a very important subject. In many ways, I think it's the most important thing happening today on our planet, in fact, for countless reasons, and I would stand by that strongly. We're talking about the most amounts of victims of violence of all time, even currently, today, and not just in other parts of the world, but here and where I'm from and everywhere in between. It's a massive topic, and it's something that most of us have never even thought about, which is the funniest thing in the saddest way, because we're all involved. We're all directly involved in this situation, in this topic. And that's sad, and it's also extremely empowering, which I'm going to get to as well. The best way I've found to share the story, to share the knowledge that I've got just over the last few years, 5 years almost now, is just to tell you how I came about it, you know, how it kind of fell into my life. Because what I'm going to talk about today a lot is non-human animals, other species. And animals they're someones that I never cared about before. You know, growing up, I never cared about animals, even dogs. I didn't even like my own dog very much, Bruce, which I feel bad about now. Don't worry, we're cool now. But before, not a big fan. And I'm just trying to tell you that because, you know, I was not an animal lover, not even close, didn't even really like them. So anyone can change. I've definitely changed. Everyone here can change, most definitely. And we're seeing change all over the world. And it's pointing to a more peaceful, compassionate, respectful, sustainable, great world, a much better world. That's what I'm talking about today, how we can create a better world. It's very exciting, and it's something we all have a part in. So I'll tell you what happened to me. It all started when I was 17 years old. I was diagnosed with leukemia and lymphoma. I was given 6 weeks to live unless I started treatment straight away. And I had it was a very aggressive cancer. So we got on the treatment straight away, which is a strong dose of chemotherapy. It was about a couple of months or so is when I started feeling the really serious side effects and when I started to really suffer. Up to this point in my life, I've never really suffered before. At this point in my life, I started getting reactions to the chemotherapy where it felt like I was getting a knife dragged up my spine every minute or so. I was screaming out loud in my hospital bed. It felt like my legs had been crippled one morning. I just woke up. It felt like someone had beaten me with bats on my legs. I couldn't walk. Bad migraines. I put on about 50 pounds so quick that I actually ripped the skin on my sides. You know how people get stretch marks? These like rip marks. And they bled. It was very intense. It was a very short amount of time. I put on a huge amount of weight. Basically, I suffered, you know, as everybody who has cancer usually does. And my first experience of suffering made me realize that this is the worst thing that we go through. You know, when you're suffering, nothing else matters. The usual things that you care about don't matter anymore. What you care about is coming out of that suffering. And it also follows then that if you suffering is the worst thing that you could go through, then coming out of your suffering is one of the best things you could go through. And then it follows that if you can help others out of their suffering, that's one of the best ways you can contribute in this world. You can help someone out of the worst thing they're going through. So it's a really powerful thing. And I learned that directly through a personal trainer who helped me lose the 50 pounds. You know, he did it almost for free, just a generous guy. He knew me before I got sick. He wanted to help me get fit and healthy and strong again. Really inspiring guy. He inspired me to want to be a personal trainer as well. I became a personal trainer. I wanted to help others out of their suffering too. I did this for 7 years. I was very passionate. I helped a lot of people lose weight, get off some meds, get some muscle, just, you know, the basics for a personal trainer. And I ended up working on cruise ships where I traveled around the world giving lectures on health and doing all the classes and meeting all these people. you know, like 1,000 new people every week. And you know, the people on cruise ships, you get all kinds of people there. Probably like Waikiki, you get all kinds of people here too. I was out on the streets the other night for a few hours and I met all different types of people. It was amazing. So it's a really special thing. And it was really cool for me to work in this environment with so many different personalities. One day, a man came in. He looked totally different from anybody else. He was wearing his suit and his shoes and he was walking on the treadmill in it. I'm like, what? This guy's lost. He's like, well, how do I get there? And we struck up a conversation. He ended up being a very, very intelligent man. And I was really fascinated by this guy, and every now and then I'd meet an especially interesting passenger. So I bring him to this chill little spot I had. We just keep talking and getting to know each other a bit over the next couple of weeks. And he's just dropping truth bombs on me, right? It's like enlightening me, just telling me about nature and about the universe and life. And, you know, half of it, I didn't even know what he was talking about. But the other half, I was like, this is really interesting. Which makes me think the other half's probably really interesting too. I just don't understand what you're talking about. And then after that, on his last day, right? His last day of the cruise, I was about to leave and I nearly got away. I was this close. I'm so glad that we stuck around for one more conversation, talking as we did. And then he said something to me that really changed the path of my life forever. He said, eating animals is bad karma. And I'm thinking, well, you're usually right about stuff I've gathered over the last couple of weeks, and I eat animals every single day, so I'm worried right now. I eat animals for breakfast, I eat animals for lunch, I eat animals for dinner. My karma's got to be bad. He said, but the thing with it was that I also believed for 7 years and my whole life as a personal trainer though as well, that there was no such thing as a healthy vegetarian. Someone had told me that years prior, someone I looked up to in the health scene kind of thing. He said those exact words and I just took them and I went, good, I never want to be a vegetarian. So this is great news for me. And then any of my clients who wanted to be vegetarian over the years, can you write me a meal plan? I'm vegetarian. I'm like, yeah, here's the meal plan. Steak, eggs, dairy. You know, you need to eat meat. You're gonna die. That's literally what I thought. Meat, protein, hello. And I said that to this guy. I said, oh, there's no such thing as a healthy vegetarian. He said, I've been vegetarian for 20 years. I said, you're lucky to be alive then. You should be dead. When you get off this ship, you go to a doctor, you need to get a blood test, they're probably gonna admit you for a while. And he was alive. For me, that was a whoa moment. I'd never known a vegetarian to be alive this long. I knew a couple in my time. So I was like, wow. And because he was so wise, you know, I was like, this karma thing, maybe I should just try it for a week. You know, see how I feel? Just give it a crack. And then if I don't make it because I can't get out of bed one morning, I'll be like, I knew that wasn't for me. That guy was wrong. So I try it out. I'm just going to be vegetarian, stop eating meat for 7 days. A few days in, already I'm feeling better. Feeling better after my meals. I'm feeling good in the gym. I'm having a good few sleeps. I'm just feeling especially good, noticeably good. I thought, okay, this was the opposite of what I was expecting, which I thought was going to be noticeably bad. So already I'm interested. Maybe I should look into this and see if this is something I can sustain. Maybe it is good, you know? I start looking into it. I had never looked into being a vegetarian before. I was never interested in it. I literally thought it was impossible for me to do because I was such a big meat eater. And straight away, as soon as I look into it, I realize, whoa, I have been very wrong about this. Not only can you survive without eating meat, but you are likely to live a longer life, sometimes adding decades to your life. Reduce your chances of the biggest killers. Actually, 14 out of 15 of the biggest killers that we're faced with can be reduced. And I was starting to think, okay, so I was completely wrong about that. I thought humans needed to eat meat to survive. So I started telling everybody, like every vegetarian does. Like, man, guess what? You gotta go vegetarian. Everybody needs to do it. And everyone's like, you were eating meat for breakfast 3 days ago or something. What the hell happened? Everything's changed. Read all this stuff. It was all about health. It's all about health. I did a lot of research because I was very interested in this. I thought, maybe I'm going to be able to help my family more, my friends more, my clients more. This is a really powerful thing I've stumbled across. Because before, anytime something had trickled in, any bit of information about the health benefits of cutting out meat, I was like, nah, I don't even want to see it. Even if I have to live 10 or 20 years less, I'd prefer to just live and eat meat. I remember one time I saw, there was this YouTube video, someone had a pan, like just a pan with two pork chops in it, you know, and they poured Coca-Cola on it. It got fizzy, and then out of the fizz came these long worms, these parasites or something. I was like, what the hell is this? Where does this guy get his meat from? You don't get meat where I get meat. My meat doesn't do that. I don't do that. You know, that's not, I don't know what's wrong with this, but basically wherever he's shopping for meat is bad. All the other meat is still good. That's pretty much what I was telling myself. And things had trickled in. I was just completely, you know, it could never be in my life. All this health information got me stoked. I start telling everybody, I'm helping my mom with it. I'm helping my clients. Just starting to see things differently. And then I start seeing this documentary that everybody's recommending. Through my research, everyone's like, yeah, the health benefits are great, but you gotta watch Earthlings. You gotta watch Earthlings, it's gonna change your whole life. I'm like, Earthlings, it sounds pretty chill. All right, we'll watch it. I use a laughing because you know. I didn't know what I was in for. Earthlings, for those who haven't seen it. Put your hand up if you haven't seen it. Okay, cool. All right, you got something to watch later. Earthlings is a real life horror movie. It shows all the ways that humans mutilate, torture, kill pigs, cows, chickens, fish, sheep, goats, and everybody in between for food, clothing, entertainment, medical testing, etc. It shows humans' dominion over animals and what that actually translates to in action. And it is extremely graphic and very hard to watch. Definitely doesn't make you hungry, seeing the way your food is prepared. And it led me to a question. You know, if we don't need to kill and eat animals to survive and thrive, what is the justification for this? Why do we do this to these animals? You know, I'm not an animal lover or anything, but I don't hate them and want them to suffer and die because of me if they don't have to. You know, am I missing something here? Maybe. I couldn't figure it out. I was thinking about it. I'm thinking, there's a great that there's all these health benefits, but I am not a violent person. I'm not a cruel person. And I would never do this myself to these animals. I'd never stab these animals in the throat or in the heart myself. I'd never push them into these gas chambers myself. I'd never separate mothers from babies myself. Unless maybe out of necessity for living. Aside from that, nah, I'll just eat something else. So I watched this and I thought, all right, I can no longer participate in this, not just for the health benefits, but for the moral reasons, for ethical reasons. So I start telling everybody that, like every other typical vegetarian. I'm like, hey, guess what? All these health benefits, I've learned even more. But that aside, have you ever thought about what happens to animals before they become that neatly wrapped package on the supermarket shelf? And most people were like, don't tell me, man, I don't want to know. Don't spoil my dinner. I'm like, I'll be spoiling it. I got some information for you. See, tell them the babies. You tell them, mate. Spread this. Alright, so I'm like all about it. I'm getting really shocked, you know. I'm telling all these animal lovers, guess what? We don't need to live by killing others. We can eat other foods that don't involve killing anybody. People are like, I don't want to know. I love meat. I love animals, but I love meat too. I'm scratching my head like, I don't think that's what love is. Like, I don't think the thing that happens in slaughterhouses has anything to do with love. And this is where I started seeing this big disconnect that I'd also been suffering from as well. And this Indian man was not done with me yet. I said, how do you know all this stuff? You've been blowing my mind for 2 weeks. He said, meditation. I was like, that sounds boring. Do you have any good documentaries you could recommend? He said, meditation is how I learned it. I was like, you sat in the corner and it came to you. Is that what you're trying to tell me with your eyes closed? He's like, yes. I was like, all right. Basically what he was trying to tell me is that when you still your mind and create space, new information can flow in. I was like, all right, that kind of makes sense. I'll do some meditation. I didn't just like start doing 10 minutes in the mornings or whatever. I booked in for a 10-day silent meditation where you meditate for over 10 hours a day. I don't know why I did that. Like, I don't know why I thought that was a good idea. I don't know what I was thinking. I wasn't thinking. Should have been meditating. Probably would have realized that was not a good idea. So I finished my cruise contract. I've got my meditation booked. I go back to Sydney. People are calling me. Are you okay, man? I was like, yes. Why? We heard you don't eat meat anymore. What happened over there? I was like, oh, dude, a lot. You're going vegetarian soon too. Wait till I show you this documentary. It's going to change everything. And I'm trying to preach to all my friends, like, hey, this thing's happening. I go to my meditation. I'm there 5 days, hating it, obviously. You just sit there for 10 hours and meditate. Like, there's no phones, there's no chilling. It's like hard work. And it's all about observing your sensations, which is the last thing you want to do when you're so bored. But anyway, I was doing it. And then this really strong sensation came over me. And I didn't know what was going on. I'd never felt it before. And eventually it started to pass. And I was like, what just happened to me? It was like this very strong, I don't know, energy thing going on. I was thinking about it. I'm like, you know what I think that was? I think it was my body trying to get me to speak. I haven't spoke in 5 days. I feel like something needed to come out and I just sort of had to push it back down. I feel like something, you know, wanted to come out. I thought, yeah, cool, I haven't spoken 5 days. That's actually pretty cool. I wonder how long you could do this for. And I thought, imagine doing this another month, like out there, you know, in the real world. That would be hard. And then I was like, oh, imagine doing it for a whole year. And like, what they don't tell you about with meditation, they don't warn you about, is when you meditate, you get real positive and all your ideas seem real good. So I was like, that's a great idea. Year-long vow of silence. I could definitely do that. I put it on my list, got back to meditation, and I'm thinking, how am I going to pull this off? You know, I've just gone back from the cruise ship, and everyone already thinks I've lost it from not eating meat. I can't get back from my meditation and be like, guess what? Just one more small thing. I'm not going to speak next year at all. People are going to be thinking I'm overdoing it kind of thing. So I thought, all right, I need to just have a reason. What could I do this for? Maybe I could do this for a way to raise awareness for something. But what would I do that for? What am I passionate about? And I was thinking, well, I'm very passionate about human health. But my newfound passion for speaking up for the animals, and I'd only been vegetarian for 3 months at this point. My newfound passion for speaking up for the animals was very strong. Because I felt like, and I still feel like this, I had woken up to this nightmare happening. You know how when you're having a nightmare and there's snakes everywhere or something? I always have that nightmare. Snakes everywhere. It scares the shit out of me. And I'm like, oh, I can't turn anywhere. I can't go anywhere. My heart's pounding. And then I wake up and I'm like, oh, I'm so glad that was just a dream. Okay, so this part of my life was more like waking up and being like, oh my God, I've been living in a nightmare this whole time. I'm walking past the meat section at the supermarket and I'm like, this looks like a morgue to me now, and I'm hearing the screams that I've seen in that documentary and the butchers. I'm seeing this decapitated individual with their body cut open, and the world's just looking different. You know, I'm seeing people in their nice suit and tie, very civilized, tucking into a corpse, right? You know, and everything was looking weird. I thought, maybe I could do it to raise awareness for the animals, because they're voiceless, you know, and I'll be voiceless. Maybe that's a good enough combination. But is this a big enough cause? I keep telling people about this, and they don't really seem to care. Even animal lovers don't really seem to care. So maybe I'm wrong. I'm only 3 months in. I'll do more research. So I do. I start doing more research. I start back where I started, the health benefits. And this is where I realized, like, this is a massive epidemic, what we've got going on right now. Everybody knows someone suffering from something, on medications for this and that. Heart disease, the number one killer in this world, the only diet proven to reverse heart disease in the majority of patients, is a plant-based diet, a diet free from all animal products. So we could save so many of our friends and family. That's what most of our friends and family are statistically going to die from. Could add years to their life, reduce so much suffering. They estimate they could drop cancer rates by 40 to 70% if everyone was consuming a plant-based diet. Not just those two things, although they're major, but also diabetes and Alzheimer's and obesity, osteoporosis, so many things that people suffer from. Actually, the place in the world with the highest amount of osteoporosis has also the highest consumption of dairy. You know, and we're told, oh, you need dairy for calcium. Well, if we need dairy for calcium and we're consuming the most amount of dairy and we're also getting the most amount of bone diseases, something is wrong here. Something is missing here. And this got me really excited for the health benefits because being a personal trainer, seeing the state of the world, seeing how much suffering there is amongst my own friends and family, I just really wanted to get everyone onto this, if for no other reason, for that reason alone. But there's so much more to the story. The environmental destruction caused by animal agriculture is the leading cause of deforestation. It's actually responsible for 91% of deforestation. It is a leading cause of species extinction, of habitat loss, ocean dead zones, greenhouse gas emissions. There's actually more greenhouse gas emissions produced by the methane that comes out of cows than by every single transportation device on this planet. They estimate by the year 2048, there will be no fish left in the ocean, basically, which who knows what's going to happen when that collapses. But basically, we're in a very serious time. We're kind of just going about our days or whatever. But at this rate, in this way, doing something that is totally unsustainable to this planet, and almost everybody contributing to that, we're going to see some serious problems, more serious problems, in the not far from here future. 2048 is not long from now. So we actually have to start thinking about this now for us and the next generations. I didn't know that about the environment. I never really cared about the environment, if I'm honest. I thought it was all sweet. I'm like, the government will sort it out. They got it under control. Actually, no. There's a lot of back and forth with money and corruption, and unfortunately, we can't really rely on people who are being funded by the very industries that need to be taken down, which makes it hard. Back to the animals, though, which is where I consistently kept coming back to, because all that's important. Human health, the environment, it's important. But what we do to the animals, not just a few animals. Here's where I was trying to say, here's some big numbers I'm going to throw at you. Right now, every year, we mutilate, we confine, we kill 74 billion land animals and 2.7 trillion sea animals. So when you do the numbers, that comes to 8 billion every single day, which is 8,000 million murders happening every day. On the term murder, we're taking the life of somebody who doesn't want to die. I don't like to call it slaughter. It's slaughter. You can call it slaughter. You can call it murder. I feel like murder is very apt. In fact, I feel like it's more apt for all these individuals who we've literally created factories to kill them at than anybody, or just as much as anybody. We're taking life of somebody who doesn't want to die. That's murder in my book. Doesn't matter who the somebody is. And this is what I mean by somebody. I always thought it's humans, it's animals, you know? It's we're up here, they're down there. They're different to us, we're better than them. Our lives are more important than them. We are animals. Which I didn't know. I actually did not know that. I told that to everybody in a speech once and they were just looking at me. I'm like, well, there goes my credibility on this one. I didn't miss that day in grade 9 science class. I don't know, I missed that. I just thought it was a totally different thing. Because that's how we treat them, totally different from us. We would never do what we do to the animals. If we would never do that to humans, although it's been done, which I'm going to talk about as well. So when I'm talking about these individuals, I'm talking about animals like us, with their own heart, with their own brain, their own consciousness, their own life, their eyes that see, their ears that hear. They breathe, they eat, they sleep, they have friends, relationships, families, communities, languages, they communicate, they bleed, they suffer, they want to live, they don't want to die. What more do we need to share in common with them? We share nearly everything in common with them. The things that we don't share, how do they look on the outside? How many times have we discriminated for that reason and realized what a bad idea that was? How many suffered because of the difference they looked like on the outside? Countless. How many is it happening to today? If we're just talking about non-human animals, 8 billion murders every day. It's a crazy amount. And this happens all over the world, every nation. Gandhi's got a good quote. He says, "The moral progress of a nation can be judged on the way they treat their animals." Every nation has slaughterhouses. Every nation, the societies inside those nations, feast on these murder victims. Totally normal, totally necessary, everyone believes, and that's actually totally wrong. So when you start to realize this, it's a heavy realization what's going on in this world. And when I realized it, that's why I decided I would do the Vow of Silence for them. Because they deserve it. I got 8 billion reasons a day to do this Vow of Silence. Have a crack at it. I'll travel around Australia at the same time, write a blog, teach people with the things I've been learning, the health benefits, some meals, you know, recipes, whatever I can. And hopefully inspire some people to move away from the way that most of us are living and to a more peaceful path. I needed to get educated. People ask me all these questions. God said it's okay to kill all these animals and eat them. You know, I'm like, did he? I didn't hear him say that. He never told me that. He should have told me if he wanted me to know that. Plants have feelings, I was hearing, and I was pretty sure that they didn't have feelings, and upon further research, they don't have feelings. They are not sentient beings. So there's no individual inside there. They react to stimuli, but there's no one home in that way where they can suffer in anywhere near the same way that we can. We also kill 6 or 12 times more plants to fatten up the animals, so it would actually reduce a huge amount of plant casualties, as well as all the land, all the water, all the food wastage and all these things. And upon more research I learned, I was not quite there yet. I was vegetarian still, right up to this time. And I remember my friend, actually my cousin, she said to me, "What's this vow of silence you're doing?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm taking a vow of silence for the animals. Do you know what happens to the animals? Have you ever thought about this before? Ever seen slaughterhouse footage, how your food is made that you eat every day?" And I was telling her this while I was eating a piece of cheese. And that's when I realized, damn, I'm being a hypocrite right now. Because it's very easy to connect with meat, with flesh. It's been cut from somebody's body. Obviously, they suffered and died for that. Dairy, that white carton of milk with that happy-looking cartoon cow on the front. Eggs, chickens just give eggs, don't they? That's just what happens. I never really thought about it. And unfortunately, I realized that it's not just about meat, it's about all animal products. It's about all the ways that we use animals. We use them in countless different ways. We exploit them constantly for their skin, for their fur. We test on them, we do all these things. We cut their tails off so other animals won't bite them in their confinement. We cut their teeth out. In the egg industry, we shred those little baby boy chicks. They drop off a conveyor belt, boom, shredded up alive because they're a waste product in the egg industry. Actually, I'm not even going to talk more about this. Some things need to just be seen. Some things need to be seen, like words can only do so much. Even seeing it can only do so much. So I'm going to show you a short video, 4-minute video. I don't usually show videos, if I'm honest. In fact, this is probably the second time I ever have out of hundreds of speeches. But I really think that to do it justice, and for us to really connect and understand, seeing it helps a lot. And I know it's not easy to watch, and I'm obviously not going to force anybody to watch it, but I would say this. If this is something that you're still putting into your body and paying for to happen, I'd really ask you to watch it. Please watch it. Please see what you are demanding happen, what you are creating a demand for. Please see what you're a part of, and we'll talk after about what we can do about it. But let's just get empowered with information. If you're very sensitive to graphic images, maybe you don't want to watch. But again, I would recommend we all see, we bear witness to their suffering, to our fellow sentient beings, to see what we're putting them through. All right, 4-minute video.
up there, actually.
All right, thanks for watching that. Sorry for everybody who's hurt by that. Like, it's... like I said, it's a real-life horror movie. This is just standard, just legal practice. You know, what do we think happens in slaughterhouses? Humane slaughter? They go in there, they skip in happily. And then something humane happens, and then they come out chopped up in pieces. This is how it happens. Like, this is how it happens. Let's say that it wasn't like this, right? Let's say that they lived a good life, which the vast majority of animal products come from places like this. Confinement, huge amount of growth hormone to get them fatter. They manipulate the lights to make the chickens grow faster. A chicken now will grow, I think it's about 6 times faster. They'll grow the same size as a 6 month chicken will grow in 1 month now. 6 month chicken back in the day. So they're not the same animals. Problem is they still feel the same. They still suffer the same. This is standard, this is legal practice. Even if it was done in a more humane way, you're robbing the life of somebody who doesn't want to die. We're breeding animals into existence, breeding sentient beings into existence for the sole purpose of murdering them later so we can feast on their bodies when we could easily just eat something else. What kind of insanity is this? Very destructive kind of insanity. Something that most people don't think about, something that most people don't want to know or even see. So I thank you all for watching that. It says here, go vegan. That's the part I'd missed. Go vegetarian, cool, I'm vegetarian, I don't eat meat. It's not about being vegetarian. It's a great start. If you want to go in that direction, that's what I did, I went vegetarian first. But that is not enough. Because being vegetarian means you still contribute to the egg industry, or the dairy industry, or the leather, or the wool, or the silk, or products that test on animals, or products that contain on animals, or you go to places like SeaWorld, for example, and none of that is okay. Not one act of that. No exploitation is okay. Exploitation is a form of abuse. Abuse is immoral. All use of animals, all enslavement of animals, forcing them to do things they don't naturally want to do, is a form of exploitation and therefore abuse. So it's about leaving them be. It's about not bringing them into existence, not creating a demand for their dead bodies. It's about extending your circle of compassion to embrace everyone. Not just dogs, not just dolphins, not just whales, not just other people, but all beings, pigs, cows, chickens, and fish included. Everybody. Why do we choose to love dogs and make them our family and feast on birds, specific types of birds? Why have we chosen that? What makes some more special than others? Who decides that? And how is this violence okay if it's unnecessary? Going vegan just means that you don't participate in it anymore. Instead of getting cow's milk, you get soy or rice or almond or coconut or hemp or hazelnut milk. You have many options now. Instead of getting meat on your burrito at Mexican, you get beans. Instead of getting sour cream, you get guacamole. Right? We've got so many options. And it's never been easier. There's never been more millions of, there's never been more millions of people doing this around the world. It is necessary for us all to be involved in. You cannot sit on a sideline of something where you are a consumer directly in support or directly funding something else. Right? I want to talk a little bit more about what we saw here just for a second. This is not any different in terms of the systematic destruction of their lives, or even the process, than what the Nazis did to the Jews. If you replace these animals with humans, you have recreated the Holocaust. Holocaust means, by definition, mass destruction mass destruction or slaughter? Is it slaughter the word? I'm actually having a... Basically, I'm fairly sure the actual definition is... that's what it is. Destruction or slaughter on a mass scale. There's no more mass scale than this. This is the biggest by far. So I realized I had to be vegan if I wanted to live in alignment with my core values, which is the same core values that most of us have. Compassion, respect, most importantly, non-violence to others. I think that's the most important thing that we all hold in our society. You know, you don't see people getting away with being violent to each other out there. We've made very strict laws about that. And if you are a violent member of society, then you're out of here. And we'll put you away. Because if you can't live with this one, like this rule above pretty much all others, then you cannot be amongst us. Because violence is probably the worst thing, no matter what form it takes. So a core value of non-violence is in us, in our hearts, in our societies. And that's why the beauty of it is that we don't need to convince anybody of something new. We don't need to say, hey, you should be against animal cruelty. Everybody already is. Everybody's already against violence. What we need to convince people to do is live in alignment with that value. And that's not a hard thing, which I'll get to soon. So I decided I needed to be vegan. I worked on it. I went vegetarian for that year. And then I planned my vow of silence. And when I was ready to start the vow of silence, it was also the time I was finally ready to become vegan. And whoa, I cannot believe that I'm only up to this point right now, because I just was told I got 10 minutes and I've got so much longer to go. So I'm going to just briefly tell you about the vow of silence and how it impacted things. And also, I'll figure out what else I want to tell you in a minute. That's why I don't usually do the videos. Nah. All right, so with the vow of silence, I traveled around Australia. I wrote my blog and I started getting a bit of a following online. I broke down in the middle of basically the other side of Australia to where I needed to be, and I cycled back across Australia to show people that you can be fit, healthy, and strong as a vegan. I wanted to break that stereotype that so many people believe you can't be healthy, you can't be fit. The world record holding strongman is a vegan. Mr. Universe of a few years ago is a vegan. World record holding ultra marathoner, world arm wrestling champion, and countless other athletes, like UFC fighters, football players, and you name it. People who eat a plant-based diet thrive because it is the diet that we're supposed to eat. We don't watch this footage and get hungry. We don't watch this footage and think about food. Some people cry. Some people are disgusted. Some people don't. Most people don't want to watch it. It's not enjoyable to watch. But when I see somebody making a vegan burger, I'm like, yeah, because I know that just came from plants. I'm not seeing the images of this violence in my eyes. So I cycled across Australia. During that travel as well, I went into these facilities to see if it was as bad as I thought it was, and it very much is. This is happening all over the world. Factory farms are a normal thing. Like I mentioned though, even if it's an organic, free-range, grass-fed facility, they all end up at a slaughterhouse, and there is no morality in taking the life of somebody who doesn't want to die. I want to tell you a bit about the dairy industry. I don't have time to tell you the whole story, but I'll briefly tell you that I connected with this very beautiful rescue. His name's Rupert, a bobby calf, which is one of the male calves born in the dairy industry. In the dairy industry, the male calves, they don't have a long life because they're not going to produce milk. So within usually a week or two, they're sent to the slaughterhouse because they're seen as a waste product. Basically, how cows give milk in Australia, we're kind of just led to believe they always just give milk. And just like humans, that's not the case. They have to be pregnant or have recently given birth. In the dairy industry, for that to happen, they will restrain a cow, a mother cow. They will force their arm into her anus so they can maneuver her cervix. Then they will inject her vagina with bull semen, which they got from jacking off a bull and collecting the semen. Restrained. Without consent, forcing things inside her to make her become pregnant. If this is happening to a human, this would be one of the most abhorrent acts that we can ever think up. And with other animals, we call it bestiality. But in the dairy industry, we call it business as usual. That's what happens all the time. They give birth after 9 months, just like a human, and then her babies are taken from her, which is a traumatic experience, which I've witnessed with my own eyes and seen how these mothers react with sadness and confusion. The baby boys are sent to the slaughterhouse. They have their throat slit after they're shot in the head with a bolt gun, and that happens about 700,000 baby cows in Australia. The mothers have the same fate. The baby girls have the same fate. They're forcibly impregnated once they're old enough. They're taken their babies from them, hooked up to milking machines every day. They repeat this process, impregnate them again, take babies from them again, over and over and over and over again. 5 to 7 years usually is as long as they last, until they're so severely used and abused that they also are profitless. They get sent to the slaughterhouse too. You can imagine what happens with leather. It's not a byproduct of meat. The leather industry is huge, and they kill animals specifically for this reason. So basically, what I'm just trying to get at in a short amount of time is that all animal products, free-range, grass-fed, humanely slaughtered, it doesn't mean anything. Put yourself in the animal's position. Ask yourself if you would like to be humanely slaughtered, if you would like that to happen to one of your loved ones. The answer is definitely going to be no, and therefore we shouldn't force that on anybody else, regardless of species. Now, when it comes to species, when it comes to the actual core issue of this, when it comes to why is this so common, normal, accepted, why? Especially even with animal lovers. It's because of a form of discrimination called speciesism. Speciesism is discriminating against other species because they're not a member of ours. Similarly to how white people believe they were superior to black people because they were in a different race. We're up here, we're white, you're black, wrong. Men did the same thing to women, wrong. Right now, a good way to explain it in a short way is this quote. Because the heart beats under a covering of feathers, scales, wings, or fur, it is for that reason to be of no account. Just because their heart beats under something different than ours doesn't mean that they suffer any different, doesn't mean that they want to live any different. We have the power to end their suffering. When we stop creating a demand for these products of violence and killing, they stop breeding these animals into existence. We lower the demand, we lower the suffering. We create a demand for plant foods, plant products, products not tested on animals, readily available. If you go to How Do I Go Vegan on Google, you'll find countless websites helping you do that. It's not hard. I did it. You know, millions of people around the world did it. My life is barely any different. I just do this at the supermarket instead of getting the breast milk from a cow because I'm not a baby cow. I get the soy milk or the rice or the almond milk. Same supermarket, same aisle, same spot. Just do that. For the most part, going vegan is literally that easy, which is so great to live in this world, because back in the day, the soy ice cream I heard was very bad. Now we've got good soy ice cream. I've got that Nana joint. What is it called? Banana. You can make that at home. Don't tell them I told you. But if you just freeze bananas and then blend them with a bit of soy milk, there you go. I blew the lid on that whole thing right now. I got to get out of this part of the country now, right? So, like, I don't know what to say. This is the reality. It's shocking. It's like a horror movie. It's like you look around and people are feasting on these dead bodies. There's another path to walk. It's healthier, it's better for the planet. Obviously, it's better for the animals. We should be having a massive focus on reducing violence in our world and increasing the peace. Nobody needs it more than they do. We are paying for them to die. It doesn't have to be like that. I should probably finish how my vow finished. So I get around, I finally cycle 5,000 kilometers, about 3,000 miles back to Sydney, solo through the desert. That was really hard. It was probably the hardest thing I've ever done, not because my legs were hurting, but because my ass was killing me, because my bike seat was very hard and I didn't know I needed a nice, chill, comfortable seat. I get back and the most popular morning TV show in Australia said, "Will you speak for the first time on our show?" And I was like, nah, because obviously I hadn't spoken a year and I didn't know what was going on here, if this was gonna be working well. And then I thought, oh, I really should, you know, for the animals. That's what I did this whole year. Okay, so I do a 10-day vow of silence, a 10-day meditation, figure out exactly what I wanted to say. I finish that, I sit down in their seat. They say, "James, what are your first words gonna be?" No, they say, "Drum roll, please. What are your first words gonna be?" And I said, "I want you to ask me why." I'd made up my whole own sign language thing going on. It wasn't very good. I said, "Oh, okay, James, why did you do this?" And I said, "Thank you for asking." It's like this. "Thank you for asking." Thank you for asking. The reason I took this vow of silence was to raise awareness for the voiceless victims of this planet, the animals. We all say we love animals and we're against animal cruelty, yet we pay people to mutilate, torture, and slaughter animals. And it's not for any necessity, it's not because we need to for our health, it's because we like the way they taste. So I went voiceless because they're voiceless, I thought. But then I realized they're not actually voiceless. They cry in pain and they scream in terror. And when they do that, they're trying to tell us that they're suffering. The problem is we're not listening because they're covered in feathers or scales or wings or fur. And for that reason, we don't take their suffering seriously. I also did this to raise awareness for the way I've been living my life. I'm vegan, which means I don't consume any animal products. I don't support any animal exploitation. I wanted to show people through my journey how easy that is, how healthy that is, how delicious the food is, and that if you agree that violence is wrong, that unnecessary violence is wrong, then it is also the way that you should live too. And I left and I had no idea what I said. My mind was just spinning. I'm like, did I talk? Did it work? What did I say? I hope I did them justice. And still to this day, that video is getting more millions of hits. It's tens of millions of people watch that, and thousands of people message me to let me know that they were inspired either to become vegan or move in that direction, or vegans to become activists. And that is the power of education. And that is the power of learning, you know, new things. But it's not just about learning the information. When you know better, you should do better. We should all try to do better for them, for each other, for this planet, for the next generations. We should do better. For us, it has never been easier to do better. It is set up for you. We have vegan ice cream. We have vegan chicken. We have vegan everything. Vegan leather. Tesla's gone vegan. They got pineapple leather in their cars now. The world is moving into a more ethical direction. And that is only because of us. Getting new information, good. Step one, applying the information. Step two, there's different ways you can go vegan. They're out there. Check out vegankit.com. That'll help you make the transition. It'll give you health information, recipes, whatever you need. Challenge22.com will give you a free mentor program where they, you ask any question. I'm going to this restaurant in this part of the world. Well, what do I do if I'm cooking for my family who don't want to be vegan? Or what about my kids at school? Boom, whatever it is, any question. It's like the vegan Google. They'll hook you up and answer all that for you. It's free. We're here to support you. We want the world to go vegan. We're gonna do whatever we can to make that happen. So that's basically it. The world can be a much better place than it already is, and it starts with each and every one of us. Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Appreciate it.
There's time for a few questions.
Oh, there's time for questions. Good. Okay, does anybody have any? The question was, we showed a documentary last night. It's like the Australian version of Earthlings, brand new, just come out. It's got drone footage, it's all investigator footage or planted cameras inside these facilities. That's basically how they got the footage. They planted long record cameras in specific areas. They went undercover. It's a hardcore movie. It's definitely the most graphic. It's 2 hours of non-stop graphic cruelty. And they said they could have made 200 documentaries on each one of the slaughterhouses. So, you know, it was really hard for them to squeeze it into 2 hours. They're very brave people who made that documentary. I've watched it 10 times. And I think I'm suffering, like I'm feeling a lot better now, but I've definitely been up and down after being like traumatized by witnessing that. That is nothing compared to what the people put themselves through in order to create it and edit it and do it. And that is nothing compared to what they actually go through. Nothing. So yeah, it's good to get perspective about it as well. Thanks for watching it. On that point, if you know, like I said, I've said a lot of words today. The documentary is Earthlings. Cowspiracy and Forks Over Knives would be my top three to recommend. Earthlings is on the ethics. It's the long version of what you saw here. It explains it, what's going on. It'll show you for the first time, probably, what is going on for meat, dairy, eggs, leather, etc. You only have to watch it once, but please watch it. Cowspiracy shows the environmental destruction caused by animal agriculture and how much better and more sustainable our planet can be on a, if everyone's eating a plant-based diet. That's on Netflix. Forks Over Knives is also on Netflix. It's based on the largest study ever conducted on the relationship between nutrition and disease. It's good. Got some fans here. And obviously the bottom line of that study, which had tens of thousands of participants and went for decades, the optimal amount of animal products in the human diet is zero. And the optimal diet for longevity and disease prevention is a whole foods plant-based diet, a vegan diet. So Earthlings, Cowspiracy, Forks Over Knives would be my top three to get more educated. That will inspire you more, it will motivate you more to make more change. You'll see more benefits in it for yourself. It seems hard. We've been eating this way our whole life. Guarantee you, it's going to be easier than you think. Infinitely more rewarding. I've spoke to thousands of vegans now over the last 5 years, and I could ask any one of them that I've spoke to, what's one of the best things you've ever done in your life? I guarantee you, I'd say 100% of them will tell you going vegan. Some of them have got kids as well, and they're like, going vegan's the best thing. Yeah. This woman here has, you know, sitting in airport, in seats on a flight, feeling that kind of confinement, thinking about the mother pigs who are in those situations for months on end without even being able to turn around. And then you bringing that up with family members or friends and saying, this is like the Holocaust, and them saying, how dare you make that comparison? What do you think the Jewish people would think of you? So I would point them towards people like, I might get his name wrong, Isaac Bashevis. Okay, I never knew how to say that middle word. Bashevis Singer, he has many quotes actually, and has written about the comparisons between the animal Holocaust and the Holocaust of what happened to the Jewish people. And there are other survivors from the Holocaust who also are animal rights activists because they can see the very clear parallels. We brand them, we separate them from their families, we truck them to these places, we put them in gas chambers. That's what you saw the pigs thrashing as they got lowered in that cage. That's a gas chamber, you know, and we experiment on them, we use them for different things. It's you know, in certain ways, If you agree that all life is equal, you know, in its own way, like, yes, we're special in certain ways, but if you come from the argument that all life is equal, and you don't need to agree with that to be vegan, you only need to agree that unnecessary violence is wrong to be vegan, that's all. But if you agree that all life is valuable, of the same value, and just because we're humans doesn't mean that we get to decide we're more valuable, chickens don't get to decide they're more valuable, life is just all valuable equally, then the amount of victims here and the amount of time this has been going on and will continue to happen, and also the extra added type of violence where we force them into existence in order to do this, this has more victims of suffering and violence in a few hours probably or less compared to any other atrocity or any other Holocaust ever. And a lot of people would say that to compare this to any other Holocaust would be an injustice for them, because they're talking about billions every day. The problem, why that happens, why people feel like that, is because of speciesism. I'm sure a lot of people would speak up against slavery and say, hey, this is like what happened to white people when they, this, whatever happened to them. People would say, how dare you make that comparison? They're black, right? And they would have felt justified in that because they were coming from the foundation of white people are superior. Right now, most people are coming from the foundation of humans are superior to the point that we can kill them just if we like how they taste. We're allowed to do that. So I guess I would suggest that explaining who they are, who these animals are, and asking the question, this is a really important question actually, what characteristic or what traits do non-human animals possess that makes them so inferior? What is it? And some people might say they're not as intelligent as us. Well, I know a lot of humans that actually are not that smart. I don't know how to build this building. I don't know how to do a lot of things. You know, some people say, oh, that humans can write a symphony. I never wrote a symphony. Is that the characteristic? Shit. You know? Or some people might say, oh, animals don't have any idea of future. You know, they're not planning for their future. Let's say that they can't. Let's say that they can't plan for their future. Some people, some humans have global, what is this? Global transient amnesia. I believe that's what it's called. I could be a little bit wrong about that. It's something like that. Where they live in an eternal present. Have you seen that movie Memento? Okay, so this dude has got tattoos. He makes tattoos on himself to remind himself of things. It's kind of a hectic movie. He ends up killing all these people, but like, he lives in an eternal present. He forgets things straight away. Let's say animals live like that. Who cares? Who cares? Cool, that's awesome. They're like enlightened Buddhas, man. That's great. They're chilling in the present all the time. That's the goal, right? So, you know, and basically the point I'm making is, you know, can they form a moral contract? Doesn't matter. We can. We have the power to be ethical or not. You know, that's on us, not on whether they can do that or not. Whether lions are going to kill so we can kill. They don't have a choice. We have a choice. It comes down to our choice that we've created for ourselves. And anyway, the bottom line is that there is no characteristic. When you get down to it, you realize it's because, oh, they're a different species. It's not because they're not as smart. We don't get to judge their intelligence anyway. Einstein's got a good quote. If you judge a fish by his ability to climb a tree, he will forever believe that he is stupid. But fish can do amazing things, and they do. They live under there. They do amazing things. They use tools sometimes. They have families and go find food and have fun. You know, they're having fun too. So it comes down to speciesism. And that's a hard thing to get people to see after decades, and not only decades, but centuries of conditioning that's taught us that we are superior. The Bible has said humans have dominion over animals. And we can take that as, oh, custodians. They're custodians, but what most people prefer to do is say, oh, cool, that means we can eat them good because I like how they taste. And unfortunately, yes, speciesism is going to be something that takes a while to unravel. So I got to stop, but, you know, there's more to learn about that. There's another documentary called Speciesism, the Movie, which is actually a really funny movie at times. It's an enjoyable movie to watch and another one definitely to get more educated on this topic. Yeah, I always say, when people are like, oh, what about pest animals? I'm like, what, you mean humans? Yeah, I know, we should do something about them. The Garden of Eden, for anyone here who follows that book, the Garden of Eden was vegan. God wants us to return to this place. If Jesus was okay with this, I would question the guy's sanity. Because I'd be like, yo, Jesus, guess what? They don't have to exist at all. We can just eat plants. And if he's like, no, this is fine, I'd be like, uh-oh, a lot of people listen to this guy. But I really don't think that's what he's saying anyway. I really don't think that's what he's saying because he was all religions, the foundation is love and compassion. And no matter what happened 2,000 years ago or whatever, right now, Jesus would be vegan. Buddha would be vegan. They'd all be vegan, for sure. Because even people who are nowhere near as loving and compassionate as them are vegan. You don't need to be a highly compassionate person. You don't need to be a massive animal lover. You don't need to be highly intelligent, interested in health, anything. One more time, I already said it, but I just want to say it one more time. All you need to agree with to be vegan is that causing unnecessary harm is wrong. And if you believe that, if you agree with that statement, then it's your own moral obligation to become vegan. Just by your own beliefs, not by what I'm telling you, by your own beliefs, that is your own moral obligation. Okay, I'll go all night. All right, sweet, thanks a lot.